Good morning to all. This is Jairam Raju from Electrical and Electronics Engineering Department of Gokaraju Rangaraju Institute of Engineering and Technology. Today, in this learning dialogue video, I am going to explain to you about the classification of buses for the solution of load flow problem in power system analysis. The learning objectives of this learning video are going to be, by the end of this video, students are able to identify and classify the different types of buses that are present in a power system, and they will also understand the significance of each and every bus, especially the slack bus. Okay. Now let us start with the classification of buses. Before I'm going to explain you about classification of buses, let us consider a simple power system in the real scenario. Let us consider this particular power system where you have different elements that are connected in the power system. If you remember or recollect, the major components that are present in a power system are going to be the generators, transmission lines, and the transformers are the major components. And along with these components, we will also have relays and circuit breakers, which are also present in the power system. Now, in order to represent such a real power system, usually we'll use one line diagram to represent the power system instead of three phase equivalents. And in this one line diagram, we represent these components with their schematics, that like generators are represented with a source, simple AC voltage source, and the transmission lines are represented with thin lines, and transformers are normally represented with two windings. Just for the simplicity's sake, the transformers are not represented in this particular power system. The interconnection of these elements like generators, transformers and transmission lines are represented with a thick line, which is represented over here, and this thick line is called as bus in our power system. In the real scenario, this bus is going to be represented, is going to represent the substations that are present in the real world. These substations are the points where these generators and transmission lines are interconnected through transformers and bus. Okay. So this bus in the real time we'll call it as substation or a bus bar. These bus bars in power system terminology are similar to the nodes in network analysis, where we'll define the node as the point where two or more number of elements are interconnected to each other, similar to this bus bar. Here, if you see that this particular bus 1, here we have the generator and the two transmission lines that are interconnected, which is forming as a bus. Okay. So these are similar to the nodes which we have defined in network analysis. And if you observe in this particular power system, we have five number of buses represented by bus 1, bus 2, and bus 3, bus 4, and bus 5. So all these buses are interconnected through the transmission lines, which are going to transfer the power from one bus to the other bus. And we have generators and loads that are connected at different buses. For example, if you take the bus 1, the bus 1 is connected to a generator 1, and bus 2, we have both generator as well as loads that are connected over here, which is represented by this arrow, and bus 3, we have only load, and bus 4, again we have only load, and bus 5, we have only load. Okay. So, at these buses, we are going to have both generators and loads that are interconnected, that are connected to the buses, and these buses are going to be interconnected with the transmission lines, which are going to form the entire power system. Now let us see how to classify these buses based upon the generators and loads that are present at each and every bus. Just if you observe, the each and every bus is associated with different parameters like PG1, QG1, PD and QD. Just if you see this, at bus 1 we have only PG1, QG1, because the generator is connected to the bus 1. In addition to these two, we'll also have the voltage magnitudes and angles that are associated with bus 1. Similarly, bus 3 is associated with only PD3 and QD3, the real power injection, their real power demand and reactive power demand, the voltage magnitude and the angle with bus 3. And also bus 4 and bus 5 are also associated with real power demand and reactive power demand, as well as voltage magnitudes and angles. And whereas bus 2, when it comes to the bus 2, we have both generation as well as loads demand. So we have this generation, real power generation, reactive power generation, real power demand and reactive power demand. And in order to define the real power injection, we are going to consider it as the net injection at this bus 2 is defined as PG2 minus PD2. That will be the real power injection at bus 2. Similarly, reactive power injection at this bus 2 will be QG2 and QD2. So, usually whenever in power flow studies, we will consider the bus injections at each and every bus, irrespective of the generators or loads that are connected at that particular bus. So, the net amount of real power that is injected at bus 3 will be minus PD3, because there is no generator that is connected and there is no real power injection into the bus. So, the net injection will become negative of this PD3. Similarly, the reactive power injection at this bus 3 will be minus QD3. So, this is how the real power injections and reactive power injections are defined at these buses, and these buses are also associated with the corresponding voltage magnitudes and angles. Broadly, these buses can be classified based upon the component that is connected to these buses. That means, if the bus is connected to the generator, you can call it as generator bus. Otherwise, if the loads are connected, then you can also call it as load bus. But in power system analysis, usually you will classify these buses based upon the components which are specified at each and every bus. Usually, for generator buses, usually the real power injection and voltage magnitudes are specified, because the generators are supposed to maintain constant voltage at that particular location, and they will have their own capacity to supply real power. So, the real power and voltage magnitudes are specified at generator buses, whereas the reactive powers and angles are not specified at generator buses. So, these are associated with only real power and voltage magnitude are specified, and reactive power and delta are not specified. So, any bus where this real power and voltage magnitude are specified and reactive power and delta are not specified, they can be called as generator buses or voltage controlled buses, because these buses are expected to maintain constant voltage. And these buses can be also called as PV buses, because P and voltage magnitudes are specified at these buses. Now, coming to the second category of buses, these are called as load buses. At these buses, the real power injection and reactive power injections are specified, whereas the voltage magnitude and angles are not specified. So, at any bus, if the real power and reactive powers are specified and voltage magnitude and angles are not specified, then you can call that particular bus as PQ bus or load bus. Okay. Now, if you assume that these are the buses that are present in the real power system, then the real power is specified at each and every bus. So, when you specify or fix the real power injections at all the buses in the system, then there will be a question of the losses that are going to occur in the system. Who are going to account for these losses? That will be a question that remains. So, what we will do is, in order to supply these losses in the system, we are going to consider one of the generator bus, usually the bus with highest generation, as slack bus. The purpose of the slack bus is to supply the real and reactive powers losses that are going to occur in the system. And another important thing about this slack bus is, At this slack bus, the voltage magnitude and angles are specified, and real and reactive powers are not specified. And usually, the voltage magnitude is considered to be 1.04 to 1.06, and angle is considered to be 0. There is a specific purpose of the slack bus. That is, since we are considering the angle at the slack bus as 0, the angles of other buses, the voltage angles of other buses are going to be measured with respect to this bus. This is again, it is just like a reference bus in case of nodal analysis, where we will assume the angle as 0. Okay. So, this is the significance of slack bus. Okay. So, this slack bus can also be called as swing bus because the real and reactive power injections are not known prior, and they are going to change based upon the load flows, load flow analysis, or load flows through various lines in the transmission system or power system. So, finally, we are going to classify the buses into three categories. One is generator bus, where real power injection and voltage magnitudes are specified, and reactive power and angles are not specified. And the second one is load bus, where real power and reactive power are specified, and voltage magnitude and angles are not specified. And the third one is slack bus, or swing bus, or reference bus, where voltage magnitude and angles are specified, and real and reactive power are not specified. So finally, the objective of the load flow is to determine these unknown quantities. That means the voltage, magnitudes, and angles are to be calculated, as well as the real and reactive power injections at each and every bus, and real and reactive power losses that are going to occur in each and every transmission line, and also the power flows in these transmission lines. That means the real power flow from bus 1 to bus 3, or real power flow from bus 3 to bus 1, as well as reactive power flows from one point to the other point in the power system. That is the objective of load flow solution. Okay.